Welcome back, fragile humans. One of the most often quoted statements about earthquakes, which does not hold universally, but is mostly true, is that an earthquake itself does not kill people. Buildings kill people. Today, we will look at the variety of risks from earthquakes, but we will start with simple shaking, or ground acceleration. When P waves hit, they often are bending up towards the surface and so come up from below. A vertical P wave might startle you, but it won't do much damage. The accelerogram shows this is mostly vertical movement, which just lifts buildings up and puts them back down, not too dangerous. But the S wave also tends to come up from below, like a slithering snake, and when it hits the surface, it starts kicking the earth side to side with more potential damage to the buildings. With the greatest movement involved with the surface Raleigh and Love waves, most potential damage occurs as these waves move through your area. The Love waves have a bit more ability to kick the feet out from under a building and make it topple than the rolling Raleigh waves, but both are dangerous to be sure. Besides causing human structures to fail, this shaking can cause steep slopes to fail as well, thus making landslides, mudslides, another very serious problem associated with earthquakes. Most known deaths from the New Madrid earthquake were from the banks of the Mississippi River falling in and killing boaters. We'll examine landslides and other mass movements in detail in a later episode. Obviously, the amount of shaking and potential damage drops off with the distance from the epicenter, but looking at the level of disturbance away from two similarly sized quakes, one near Los Angeles and the other the New Madrid quake, we see the effect of bedrock geology on the range of destructive seismic waves. The West Coast is on a plate boundary near a shore. The combination of broken, fractured rock and high water content help to damp out seismic waves and keep them from having the damaging reach of an intraplate quake like New Madrid. So competent rock can transmit seismic waves farther with more efficiency. But in a more local sense, it is better to have your building founded into solid bedrock rather than loose unconsolidated sediment. When you see the amount of shaking and damage increase as you move away from the epicenter, it's a good bet that the waves are moving toward more loose surface materials, which can be moved around more easily. It can also be that the reflection and refraction of waves allow for dissipation and concentration of energy with distance from the epicenter. These multiple incoming waves can also experience interference with each other, and that could mean one local area gets negative, damping interference and less shaking and damage, while another nearby location got positive, constructive interference and more severe shaking and damage. Related to interference of the waves is resonance with those waves. Now, if we shake our slinky at any rhythm, it looks pretty inefficient. But if I watch the slinky's natural bouncing frequency, its rhythm, then add energy at that same frequency, I get resonance and more of the energy transmitted efficiently to the slinky until it builds up to a destructive threshold. So it can be with structures at the surface being shaken by seismic waves. Even a relatively low energy wave can do severe damage to a structure if it is in resonance. All this shaking of the earth can cause fractures to open up, doing further damage to roads, buildings, and other infrastructure. False cutting to the surface can create fault scarps that cut completely through infrastructure. Now, some of that easily damaged infrastructure includes gas pipelines and water mains. Broken gas lines and sparks due to friction and arcing of frayed wires are a bad combination. And along with tipped over candles or other open flames, fire is a major risk immediately following an earthquake. After all, the 1906 San Francisco earthquake was better known as the Great Fire of San Francisco. Most of the damage in the most expensive earthquake in history, the Kobe, Japan quake of 1995, was due to fires that swept through the rubber and textile industrial areas. Besides earthquakes producing the possibility for fires to start, the breaking water mains and blocked roadways, and in the case of the Great Fire of San Francisco, a fire chief killed in the quake itself, all make fighting these fires so much more difficult, allowing them to spread out of control. The break of water mains can also cause sinkholes to form and water to erupt at the surface, but look closely in a case like this. It could be a broken water main, or it could be that the sediment below your feet was saturated with water trapped between solid particles, and when the shaking takes place, those particles can jostle and jiggle around and settle into each other, becoming more compact and squeezing out the water between the particles. While the grains are moving around, the whole ground starts to behave like a liquid. This phenomenon is known as liquefaction, and it often is accompanied by jets of water shooting up out of the ground and making volcano-like sand boils, or blows, at the surface. To make a sand boil yourself, mix gravel, sand, and clay in a bottle with water, shake it up, let it settle into a grated bed with a decently thick clay cap, then tap on the sides to simulate an earthquake. The results are rather pleasing to watch in a bottle, but in a city under attack by an earthquake, it is anything but pleasant. Other gases, such as methane and hydrogen sulfide, erupt to the surface with the sand boils and often give the air an unpleasant odor. But more concerning is when the solid earth below you literally turns to liquid. The Mexico City earthquake of 1985 was as bad as it was because the city is on an old lake bed deposit which has loose, unconsolidated, waterlogged sediment. As the ground below them shook and turned to liquid, buildings simply sank in or fell over. In the Good Friday Alaskan earthquake of 1964, a whole neighborhood ran into the sea as the ground liquefied under them, and then they got hit by the resultant tsunami. Until recently, we had very few images of the giant sea waves called tsunamis that earthquakes in or near the ocean can produce. It's not good news that that has changed in the last two decades. The 2004 Indonesian tsunami killing around 250,000 people, and the 2011 Japan earthquake and tsunami which caused failure of the Fukushima nuclear power plant, we have all too many images of tsunamis and their overwhelming destructiveness now. We see that, though in some cases you can get a substantial wave with the tsunami's approach, the general threat is that the ocean just keeps coming up and up over the land, and then draws rapidly back out to sea, taking all with it. When out in deep water, the energy from the earthquake is given to the water and produces a large Raleigh wave, which travels out from the disturbed area. If you are on a boat on the open water, you may not even notice as your boat rises and falls over this large wave. You might notice odd water currents or a somewhat disturbed surface at the most. But on the beach, the changes are more dramatic and start with the water drawing offshore as it is gathered up into the approaching tsunami wave. This is your warning. If you are ever at the beach and the water pulls out to sea, exposing shore that should be underwater, run, and run uphill. There is a good chance you already felt the faster seismic waves in an earthquake before the destructive wave hits you, and if that's the case, you should already be running uphill away from the shore. A last risk of earthquakes is, well, other earthquakes. A main shock is the biggest energy release in a series of pops, what we might call a seismic swarm. Smaller quakes before the main shock are called foreshocks, and those that come after are the aftershocks. Aftershocks are often more numerous and more powerful than those foreshocks, which are those pop, 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 pops before the big crack. Once the big crack occurs, other areas on the fault and nearby may need to readjust and release the new stresses and aftershocks. Considering a main shock can do all kinds of structural damage without total failure, these aftershocks become that much more dangerous when they finally occur. Smaller kicks can possibly destroy an already compromised structure. The Pacific Northwest is a bit of a case study for all of these risks. The first evidence of the severe earthquakes that can periodically hit the Seattle area came from sand brought in and deposited in muddy wetlands by tsunami waves. And then the evidence came in of a submarine landslides. And there are probably landslides on land, of course. But the submarine landslides, turbidites being shaken off the shore into deep water during these violent events. And then the submerged stands of trees that seem to have been suddenly sunk down below sea level and inundated, only to be slowly pushed back up above sea level again. Areas of Seattle will experience liquefaction, and we can expect falling buildings, bridges, and the fire risk. as well. A recent New Yorker article did a good job covering these potential risks and caused a more public awareness in the affected areas. Many were alarmed and asking if this article was an over-exaggeration of the risks, and unfortunately, it was not. For areas that are cursed with periodic terror tremors, we know we can't stop the earthquakes from happening. So the best we can do is be alert and prepared. When we come back next time, we look into our ability to predict earthquakes for your town and how to protect your community. Here on Earth Explorations.